Hello, gang. I'm back. We're just starting early. Before I started, I took some of my oil sticks and just made some dark red, red, and blue marks. Those will mostly disappear. But not entirely. It's a little too red, isn't it? Add it some green to the mixture. So this is, of course, oil now, and I'm using liquid. This is my medium, the original gel. This for you guys. And as you can see right now, I'm just largely getting a warm but not too warm. A couple 2 weeks ago, I did a wedding, and one of the people there called this stage antiquing. She said, you know, when you antiqued it, that's funny. I'd never thought of using that term before for this, but I could see what she meant. Documenting the whole thing quite a bit. The next thing I'll do after doing whatever color glazes, you notice I just darkened all the corners pretty much. And that's by no means a hard and fast rule, especially with wedding paintings, interior scenes, and trying to get the focus on the bridegroom. I usually find that vignetting the corners is usually pretty effective. Now, that's basically done. Do I want to add any color to this? Yeah, let me try a little bit. That's enough of that. Now, okay, I'm going to rag here tonight. That's kind of weird. So now I'm going to lift out the first one. It's dried. Once again, there's pretty typical for me. There's a fictitious slight ray of light. By fictitious, I mean it's certainly not in the photograph, but it's not hard to extrapolate that from the photograph either, so it's not. I don't want people necessarily saying, hey, look, he put a ray of light shining on the bride's head. I don't want that. I want people to experience it without necessarily noticing it. You see this kind of light area right there? It's about here, right here. Maybe it's more of a V-shape. Okay. I'm going to flip it back to the spot. See, how much comes off depends how hard you dark, how long you dark. That's good. Now, question to sometimes I do a fuzz taste. I think I'm going to do a fuzz layer. A little bit unusual, but not extremely. So I'm going to do fuzz first. And either draw with paint or draw with pencils, whichever. I'll decide in a moment. Start by doing some. There's two windows over here. Once again, I'm focused on keeping or creating some real details. The overall painting is going to be as it is now. It's going to be very for that reason. Not too much. More fuzz this time. Well, let's do the brights. Really, the dress is going to be the main thing to get that I want to learn. I thought that was warm, but it wasn't. I had too much light in it. It is true. I want her glowing like a light bulb. Okay? That's what a bride does at a wedding. She glows at a reception. She glows like a light bulb. There's a bar back here. A couple lights hanging down. Now, let's do the glow around these. This is what I'm doing now, by the way. Pay attention. This is classic. How do you paint? How do you make something look like it's glowing? And right now I'm doing these antique sort of light bulbs, strings, wires, right? So how do you make them look like a glow? The answer is you paint the glow first and the light second. Let me use an obvious example. How do you paint a candle? You want the candle to look like it's glowing? The answer is you paint the glow around the candle first and then you paint the flame with a slightly hard edge. Does that make sense? Not the other way around. You don't paint the flame with a hard edge. I mean, you could do it this way if you want. But if you want to do it the hard way, that's how you do it. Okay? You don't have to do it. You want to do stuff easier, brighter, faster. So, that's how you do that. You paint the glow first, and then the item, the thing that's glowing, you paint that second. So in this case, all these light bulbs up here right now, they're just very rough smudges, as you can see, just very smudgy. growing in this. It took me a long time to get brave enough to do what I see to paint this wildly crazy. One of the main reasons I have the courage to do it is because, of course, the painting's not done right there. Okay, so that's my fuzz layer. This is as loose as my painting is going to get. This is as soft as it's going to get. Softer than it's going to end up. Much of what I do for the next many minutes will tighten up the hardened edges. The challenge is not overdoing it. I think I'm going to draw with pencils first. As I said, there's always that question, do I paint with, draw with brushes, or do I draw with pencils? And I think I'm going to draw with pencils. Maybe a little bit of the bright green. I thought I was going to do that. Turn it upside down so that I can keep the power pack plugged in. At some point tonight, I'm probably going to start running out of juice. I only have 4 functioning battery packs. So time to buy some. Okay, so now let's tackle drawing these lovely people. Thank you. another obstacle, challenge in my way, a barrier to good drawing. I don't do it because
it's cake, right?
Yeah. I don't do it because it's easier. I actually draw with my left hand because it's slightly more difficult. And it sounds strange, so hard to describe, but that little extra bit of intensity, focus, concentration that is required to overcome the left-handed change, the wrong drawing. I think my music just forces me to zone in, to be in the zone with a little bit more intensity. It's so weird, so counterintuitive. My right hand draws so quickly, smoothly, so it doesn't attack me. She's an attractive woman. I have a slight proxy. Scotch face forward. Thank you. cake over here. Tonight. So now I'm going to draw with dark oil paint, transparent effects.
I'll see you next time.
Probably, as they always do, they'll just say, we're not going to take this video down, but we can't make any money. Fair enough, I say. I want this stair angle, staircase, to go behind Kelsey's head. So I want it to fade out. I think it's up there. I don't want it to crash it. I just want it to gently disappear behind. Okay, let's look at this this railing from the recording system. Yeah. All the curvilinear elements over that. That's my problem. So I'm drawing it carefully, really for the first time. Most of this railing, this wrought iron railing, the finish of it will be rendered in negative painting. I've said this before, but it's been a while, I'm going to say it again. For you artists, you want to use any excuse you can to paint in the negative. That is to say, to render things, not by rendering the things, but by rendering the stuff behind it. A classic example is tree, sky holes, but in this case, it's going to be these wrought iron railings. They're going to be delineated most accurately, most specifically, by the negative paint, because I paint around it. And it would be good for you to say, why? How come? Why do I say that you should look for excuses whenever possible to paint in the negative? And the reason, well, to use untechnical language, the answer is because negative painting is charming. Negative painting is interesting. Negative painting, again, by negative, I mean you don't paint the object, you paint the stuff around the object. And it's charming because our brain doesn't expect it. Our brain, well, let's use this, my typical outline, simple example. If you're painting a landscape, and you paint sky, everybody knows that the mountain is in front of the sky, right? There's no such thing as a sky that's a mountain that's further away than the sky, right? You with me? So you paint the sky first, and then you paint the mountain. That's what your brain expects to see. So let's just stop right there. So therefore, when you're painting the edge of the mountain, a beginner will paint the sky, and then paint the mountain. Again, we're talking here in oil or acrylics, not watercolor. Watercolor is actually the opposite, but That's another subject for another time. So a beginner painter, a novice or early journey painter will paint things logical. Sky, mountain, hill, tree, barn, horse, fence, weed. That's a weed, you know, a piece of grass in front of the fence. That's what your brain expects to see. Your brain expects to see mountain paint. Can you understand what I'm saying?
You can.
Dang, yes. Is this any better? Your brain expects to see mountain colored paint on top of sky colored paint. Does that make sense? And if the barn is in front of the hill, then your brain expects to see barn colored paint on top of, around the edges, along the edges, on top of the hill colored paint. Are you with me? So here, our brain knows that this railing, that this wrought iron grid rail is in front of the stairs. The stairs are behind it. Our brain knows that. So our brain expects to see what it sees right now, dark paint on the top of the stair colored paint. Right? That's what we expect. Therefore, every time you can throw the viewer, the viewer's brain, a little curveball, the mind experiences that as a momentary flicker of confusion, which it experiences as pleasure, aesthetic pleasure. Boy, that was a long way to go around, wasn't it? Somebody don't need to hear that. Right? So you always look for it. So that's what I'm going to do here. What I'm doing right now by painting positive is this is just the setup. This is just the getting ready to do what I said a minute ago. All right, let's go to sure, I picked the right photograph. I almost started pulling, looking at the wrong photograph in my room. Again, what I'm doing right now is quick dark details. It's a little too red for her. I'll fix it. Just a hint of the electric wires that are holding up those lights. Just a hint. Let's bring up a photograph of the cave. I better look at that. Got it too skinny. Mm-hmm. just messing stuff up. You know? Okay, before I leave this stage, my question is, do I have adequate darts? Do I have enough dart stuff in place? And I'm not sure that I do. I think I'm going to add just a little bit. If you've watched me very many times before, then you know. Hey, I lost my checklist too. That's funny. Here's my live chat. Huh. I'm ready to start doing some final edit layer. Whew. And I don't know why my chat is not working. I seem to be broadcasting okay. Maybe nobody's saying anything. It's very possible. All right. Take a minute to clean some of my larger brushes that I use for glazing. I keep dropping my phones tonight. Fortunately, I have a couple layers of carpet underneath, so I'm not suffering too much. I seem to be avoiding the bride and groom. I'm going to keep avoiding them a little bit longer. I'm going to do some start painting some of the final edit in the background here. So the final edit layer is really for the first time in the whole painting. I'm going to paint with opaque colors. And that is to say, I'm going to start painting the way most other oil painters paint all the time. I was thinking about student painters sometime recently. I wasn't painting when I was thinking, so this was just free floating illumination. And I settled on a truism, something that's almost always true, a beginner, early journey painters. I don't like to call people beginners. And that is that, generally speaking, early journey painters don't put their paint down thickly enough. A lot of beginner paintings tend to be wispy and feathery, translucent wisps of paint, which is kind of ironic because that's just what I put down. That's because I wanted it, because I know what I'm doing. But I'm not sure why it is. One crazy possibility might be that beginner painters don't want to waste paint. They're reluctant to put the paint down because they don't want to use it up. They're afraid of wasting. I know that is the case sometimes. I don't know how widespread that is. But I think it might be worth mentioning. I had a teacher one time, very clever guy, said you cannot both paint and save paint at the same time. So if you want to begin to be a painter, I think you really must get over that impulse, that overly thrifty mindset. It hampers your painting. So, that's all I'm going to say about that. I might be all wet, but I think I'm probably not. There's some truth to that. Both statements. One is that beginners seem to have a hard time laying down fairly thick slabs of paint. That's a relative term, because even what I'm putting down right now is fairly thin, but it's thicker than the stuff I'm talking about, the accidental wispy stuff. Never paint with your fingers. I feel obligated to say that every time I paint with my fingers. Much of my concern at this stage, well, at every stage, but maybe especially at this stage, as I'm getting closer to completion, I wouldn't say I'm close yet, but it's getting closer. A very heavy guideline for me is the word energy. Okay, the old timers. My regular listeners are saying, oh man, not that again. But I'm obvious, well, I think it's obvious, it's supposed to be two people on this side of the bar, two people on that side, some lights hanging down, some, a bar. Well, this is a cake down here in front of it. And I think, I believe everything I just said is discernible. That is, you could tell, everybody can tell what it's supposed to be, I think. But a chief concern is not, as you can tell by the, because somebody might, a beginner, again, might say, man, I can paint more realistic than that. And indeed, you can. That's part of your problem. I'm much more concerned with the abstract marks themselves. But the word I was getting to is energy. I'm very concerned about levels of energy. What creates energy? Contrast, light and dark, hard edges, and intense color. And then psychological energy is the presence of people. So all of those things. Things that I'm very much thinking about. Just thinking intuitively, if you will, but still thinking, how much do I do over here? Like on this rail down here, how much do I do? Am I increasing or diminishing energy? I'm increasing it actually ever so slightly by adding color. A definitive stroke also is more energetic than an abstract stroke. A stroke of realism draws a little more attention to itself, thus energy. Draws a little more attention to itself than a more abstract one. Do what I talked about a little while ago, negative painting. That is rendering objects, rendering things, in this case the railing, going up the stairs here, rendering them not by painting the thing, but by painting around the thing. So I said earlier, you should always look for an excuse, if possible, to paint in the negative. Here in just a little bit, I am going to start working on the bride and groom. I want the people here to feel like they've seen, you know, a real painting process. And if I left the bride and groom the way I am right now, people would feel like he didn't do much of what I was doing. So, but I wanted to cover some more acres first, and I'm getting there. I'm achieving that. I can leave it for the moment. So, do you see this? It's beginning to look like what it's supposed to look like. These pale, obtuse arcs of iron, wrought iron, going in opposite directions. But I want it to look like that without overdoing it, without obsessively painting it. I'll do the same thing up here. Not to the same degree, much less up here. Another way to describe what I think is good painting is the viewer's mind, all viewers, including my own, me when I'm the viewer, the viewer's mind likes to connect the dots. We like to finish the picture in our brain. Now, don't get me wrong, we're darned impressed when a good drawer or renderer, you know, renders the heck out of something and does every, you know, like I said earlier about Bob Timberlake, draws every leaf on the tree and draws every hair on the dog. You know, that's impressive. It is. But I contend, I don't know that I can prove this, but I believe that it's that we're impressed, that's, I call it an industrial buzz. That is to say, we're impressed by the hard work and industry, attention to detail, time, and so on and so on. Do you see how I'm using that word? Not in the normal sense of industry, but we're impressed by the industry, the industriousness, if you will, of the artist. We go, wow, look at that. How long did that take? Right? That's exactly the kind of thing we say about super realism, right? So, and that is a form of pleasure. That is a kind of pleasure. People do get a kick out of it. In spite of what art professors have been telling us for nearly 100 years now, they've been pulling our leg. Because they say, nah, people don't like realism. Well, the fact is, people do. Even I do. Even I do. I do the same thing when I see one of those, you know, of course, the internet is full of that stuff. But I believe, as opposed to an industrial buzz, our brain gets an aesthetic buzz when in fact we finish the picture. So, you know, I'm broadcasting this whole thing.
Cool.
On YouTube. So when you're bored, 3 years from now, there you go. There.
So you can. Yeah. That's right.
So you can watch me paint the whole thing. Thank you. And of course, I'm going to take it home and make y'all as beautiful as you really are.
Thank you. Sing-along song. Hey, how come I can't hear myself?
Oh, I came out, okay. And you sing. What an amazing sing-along song. Everybody joins in, that's crazy. I don't know if they do that on the rest of the country. In North Carolina, they do. Distancing just went out the window. There's somebody talking in the background. Hang on. Good grief, this guy's been talking all day. It's been somebody talking in the background all of the last hour. Oh my goodness. Now, let's get a little bit of jazz.
Thank you. Jesus. And what I noticed,
white dress is going to get at least three more layers of paint on it, at least, before I'm done. This is all I'm going to do tonight, is I'll leave it this way, but when I get the painting done, I will do another glaze, probably a warm glaze, the whole thing. See the dark, because before that everything in this black tux was just black. It was just pure black. And I couldn't see anything. I couldn't see where the crease of his sleeves was sleeve ended and so on. So now that I've exaggerated the lightness.
So we can all just focus on this.
Thank you.
It's amazing. I cannot tell you how many people are like,
oh good. Thank you.
So cool.
Thank you.
Oh,
well, and as you know, I was saying earlier, you're the only person in the room who wasn't nervous.
Oh, I know. They're like, what?
Everybody else is like, what?
It's amazing.
Thank you.
It feels good to have you here again.
Oh, good to be here. Thank you. Thank you, thank you. You're sweet. Thank you.
I've been back here all the time. It's been kind of iffy, hasn't it?
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, it's amazing. Oh,
So now I can see in the photograph where the dark details ought to be. And here is a good, hear ye. You know that thing you've all heard? Don't use black. Well, I'm about to show you why that's wrong. I parroted that same expression just like everybody else. But the fact is, let me save this. There are times when you should use black. And this is one of the best examples of that. The answer is, when you're painting something black, and you want to paint the shadows on the black thing, in other words, a black tux, this is exactly, and yes, I've tried this, by the way, using what I call chroma black, which is, of course, is what the art professors and I told you for years, don't use black, you know, mix up transparent colors, and that's, I do that, of course, extensively. I mean, 95% of the time, when I want something more perfect, I'm running out of energy here. When I do something, ninety-five percent of the time, when I paint something dark, I use chroma black. That is to say, I mix. And my favorite, my go-to, is typically burnt sienna or oxide red, and ultramarine blue. Sometimes I'll add violet, and sometimes viridian green, and so on and so forth. But anyway, I make my blacks that way 90% of the time. But when you're painting something that is, the object is actually pitch black, like a suit, like a tux, and you want to paint the creases like I just did, you can't do it with, you cannot do it. Hang on just a second, I've got low battery in here. Oh, I see why. Okay, hang on just a second, I need to switch out battery packs. Ha! Okay, gang, I'm running out of energy, and evidently all my battery packs are on their last legs, so let's see if I can soak any more juice. Looks like I'm going to be ending this broadcast shortly, which is fine because I'm going to finish painting soon, too. So I need to buy some more battery packs. We'll go as long as we can. Okay, now that I've painted the dark details on this black tux, now I'm using the black, straight up black, mixing it with straight up white to get a straight up gray. Now, I'm not with this gray, with this opaque gray, I'm not going to cover up, of course. I'm
I'm going to leave Leslie and Scott and do some more in the background. Most people will feel like they're done. They're not. They're all done. You know, but at least we've done enough that people feel like they've seen some of the process. Well, they have seen some of the process. Not as much as they do. I still probably have an hour and a half to go. Maybe an hour on each of those faces. So I probably have an hour to go on each of those faces. You know that.
I know, I've seen it.
Everybody else doesn't know that, but. People coming to the mic now to sing, some of whom have drunk a little bit too much. I'm just saying. All right, let's do, I know what will help people feel like this thing is popping, is if I come in here and pull these mics. Are you still with anybody? I talked earlier about paint the glow first and then put the thing which glows. Guys are pretty good at acoustic guitar playing. Real stuff. Well, thanks for watching me tonight. A few of you who did. The rest of you, thanks for watching later. Actually, I'm able to see me paint. Just an entire wedding painting. Call the final edit layer, which is what I'm doing right now, which essentially means I'm painting
in opaque colors. A big part of this process is mixing up paint on my palette like a traditional painter that matches or very closely, slightly lighter than what's already on the canvas. But essentially, it matches what's already on the canvas. So like I just mixed up some orangish green, green-orange, because it was already there. And then painting it with thicker strokes than what was there. So that's what we're doing a lot more of that. Next week, I'll finish this painting, hopefully. I have three wedding paintings that all need finishing now, so that's good. I've got a lot of work, so I should be able to do a lot of broadcasting, I hope, this coming week, if my schedule doesn't get crazy. Too much energy over here, by the way. You see that? The dark outlines is too drawing too much attention. Let me do some opaque paint on top of what's there. Just to push it back a little bit so you don't look at it quite so readily, so quickly. I don't want to either linger. I want to just skim over those edges and those corners. When I come back to this painting next week, and I can't hear myself. Can you guys hear me? Yeah, okay. When I come back to this painting next week, the first thing I will do is glaze the whole thing. And then I'll probably do another fuzz layer, flow layer, and then dark details and light details, something like that. In other words, I'll be doing several of the same steps that I did tonight, just doing them over again, a little bit more refined. And of course, I'll completely, not rework them, but I'll completely finish working on Scott and Kelsey. My brain is going on slow, can you tell? Let's go back to this cake for just a minute. Again, I don't want it to stand out huge. I want it to be kind of subtle. It's really just a nod to the cake, if you will. But it did have a red flower on top. Let's get that in there. That's easy enough. And some green leaves. And the Scott, the groom, also had a green flower in his lapel. So let's do that as well. Purple, a little tiny purple flower. I hadn't really looked at it carefully. About time that I did. I think the party's over, gang. So, yahoo, right? Just in time for my battery to die. Thank you again for hanging out with me this evening. And the rest of you for watching this later. Scott and Kelsey, I wish you all the best. It's been really fun being a part of your family's special event tonight.
Thanks for letting me be a part of it.
And with that, I'll say goodnight to all of you. Good night, all of you. Bye-bye.